I need all of my reactive praises to give God a praise right now. Come on, give God a praise right now. Come on, when you do that, let's give God a praise. Hallelujah. Now I see what the problem is. We got a lot of reactive praises, but there are some of us that call proactive praises. That means that we didn't get it yet. But I'm going to praise God in advance. See, when you see me clapping my hands, I'm prophesying. When you see me open up my mouth, I'm prophesying. Do I have anybody got a praise that ain't got it yet? You ain't even got it yet. It's not even in your bank account yet. You're not even driving it yet. You're not even living it yet. But I'm going to praise Him like I already got it. Come on, since we're here, we're not trying to have church. I'm going to praise Him like I already got it.
Soaking wind, we done had a revival. Well, the fire is still burning. Amen. And I'm excited about what God is going to do today. Can we put our hands together and give God a praise? Can we give God a praise for our leader, Mr. Bryant? Come on, give God praise for the first lady. Amen. Into this program coordinator. We are going to have our opening song by Whistler, Greg, and the family, family and friends choir. After that, we have the prayer by Minister Holmes. Scripture by Craig Harris, and then we will go immediately into praise and worship. Let's receive them by the words of amen. Listen, before we go forth, look at somebody and say, loosen up. Come on, tell them, since we're here, come on, say it like this. Since we're here, we might as well have church. Come on, put your hand together. We're going to give God glory. He's worthy to be worthy. Oh, the Lord is high above the heaven.
The Lord is high above the heaven.
And the glory above the nation.
And the glory above the nation.
The Lord is high above the heaven.
The Lord is high above the heaven.
And the glory above the nation.
And the glory above the
nation. Oh, the Lord is high above the heaven.
The Lord is high above the heaven.
And the glory above the nation.
And the glory above the nation.
The Lord is high above the heaven.
The Lord is high above the heaven.
And His glory above the nation.
And His glory above the nation.
Give God the highest praise. Now let's chant in all the ways. All the people shout, Hare, Hare, Hare.
Hare, Hare, Hare.
Hare, Hare, Hare.
Hare, Hare, Hare.
I'm
standing on our feet, preparing our minds and our hearts for prayer. Father God, we come right now saying thank you for this opportunity to worship in spirit and truth. God, this prayer could be over a bereavement service, but today we are celebrating Friends and Family Day. Lord, we thank you for that. We thank you for the vision behind this. If you look around and you feel the presence of the Holy Spirit, we want you to stay right there. The songwriter says, dwell among us. So he'll be dwelling among us. So do your work today, God, and we thank you for all that's about to happen. Let us not just hear it, but let us be doers of what's delivered to us today. Lord, we thank you for the leadership in this church. But most of all, we thank you for sending your son to the cross for us. Oh God, we love you and we honor you and we give you praise. And the people of God said, amen. Amen.
Psalms 104, verse 33, then Psalms 105, verses 1 through 3. I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. 105. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among his people. Sing unto him. Sing songs unto him. Talk ye of all his wondrous work. Verse 3. Glory ye in his holy name. Yes. Let the heart of them that rejoice seek the Lord. Amen.
Come on, put your hands together all over the building. Let's give God a break. Come on, one more time for the Lord. Not for me. Come on, let's give him a real big praise. Hallelujah. Come on, we ask that you help us invoke the presence of the Lord. Come on, do me a favor. Get on your feet all over the building. Come on, put those hands together. The sanctuary.
Magnify the Lord with me.
Magnify the Lord with me.
Hold the sun, the high.
Hallelujah. Come on, do I got any worshipers in the building? Any real worshipers in the building? How many of that God is able to do anything that you ask? Come on, I need some real worshipers in the house. Hallelujah. Exceedingly, abundantly, above all you can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. Promise you, oh, don't you never. give up on God. Come on, that's a real good place to give him the praise. Don't you dare give up on God. He won't give up on you. Don't you dare give up on God. Cause he won't give up on you. Help me say, don't give up on God.
Home. Some of y'all, the whole service, I want everybody to step to your feet.
and give God a praise. Amen. For a great leader. Amen. Bishop Bryant Sr. Come on, Prince Bryant. Give God praise for him. Amen. What a wonderful man. Awesome man of God. Fifth time. Amen. The jewel of this house. The jewel. Amen. Of this church. Amen. One of the greatest flowers that we have in the church of God in Christ. Let's receive her. Amen. First Lady Yolanda Bryant. Come on, make some noise with her. After her, you'll be back into the hands of the choir.
Good afternoon. Obedience to God on this evening, to Bishop Bryant, to all of the men of God, to our speaker on this evening, to all of our family and our friends. Family and Friends Day is here. We feel the excitement in the atmosphere. We thank God for this wonderful opportunity for our church members to invite their loved ones and friends to attend church with them, to share their faith, to learn about God's love, and experience a rich fellowship. Today, I pause to extend a warm welcome to our family and our friends, our virtual audience, our invited guest psalmist, Lady Latrina Oliver, Lady Charisma Evans, and our speaker of choice, Superintendent Nathaniel Green, President of the International Youth Department of the Church of God in Christ. We welcome you to the historical Buck Street Memorial Church of God in Christ. We have anticipated this time of fellowship and worship with our family and friends, and finally, finally, the day is here. Our theme this year is the danger of a divided house. Abraham Lincoln said, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." What did he mean? He simply meant that our nation could not last with one half free and the other half bound in slavery. Jesus said in Mark 3:25, "A house divided against itself cannot stand." When there is major division in anybody, such as in a kingdom where leaders form opposing sides of significant strength and influence, that kingdom will be destroyed from the inside. A house divided against itself, that house cannot stand. So it is with family and friends when they are splintered by feuding. They will fall apart. And if family and friends continue to feud, their houses will not last. But today we know that where two or three are gathered in the name of Jesus, the Spirit of God is among them. We are happy to have his presence with us here now. And I'm going to borrow a phrase from my First Lady Karen Clark Shear. She often reminds the women of the Church of God in Christ that united we stand and division is not an option. We're very happy to welcome you to our services and pray that this won't be your last time visiting. On behalf of our pastor, the Bishop Prince E.W. Bryant Sr., General Board Member of the Church of God in Christ, our coordinator, Deacon Daniel Wright, of our Family and Friends Day, along with the entire membership of the Buck Street Memorial Church, we extend a warm and cordial welcome to each of you, our family and friends. We pray that the love of God be with you always. And as I take my seat on today, I'm going to ask the Buck Street family, if you will, help me to welcome our family and friends.
Thank you.
God praise for this choir. Hallelujah. All the folks say right about now, them cheering, singing. Hallelujah. Amen. We are so grateful to be here. Amen. What a such grateful atmosphere. Amen. I was just instructed. I was moving this train just a little bit too fast. Amen. But I'm ready to hear the word of God. Amen. All of us are singing. Amen. I'm ready to hear what God has to say to the church. Amen. Amen. But at this time, we're going to have, amen, someone to come to represent family, Ruby Horace. Amen. And then friends. Amen. Claudette Hunt. Let's receive them in that order and by the words of amen.
To share this afternoon. I promise I'll only be here for a couple of minutes, but I wanted to use this time to be transparent, amen? And if you will allow me to share my testimony, I pray that it will bless you, amen. There is a war against the family. The structure and the institution of family is being disseminated daily. And you see, when you see me, I'm what they call a fixer. I was the one that wanted everybody to be okay, to help them answer their problems, and to be the voice of reason. God blessed me, so I wanted to be a blessing to my family. With a giving heart, I didn't mind helping, even when there were times where I was not in a position to do so. Little did I know that what I was doing was becoming a little God while God was being put on the back burner for my family. What I learned after some time and frustration, that oftentimes family wanted what I had most, but the times they didn't want my words. What I mean is they didn't want to receive the correction, but they would tolerate me for a period of time to get what they wanted. Attempts to provide insight into what could be done differently were meant, I know, but just this one last time. Can anybody relate? Amen, amen. In turn, I would complain, distance myself, grow weary, and repeat this vicious cycle over and over and over again. Until one day the Lord tapped me on my shoulder. He said, Ruby, open your eyes. He tapped me again and says, I am God, and besides thee, there is none other. Amen? You see, I was more of the problem than the solution that I really wanted to be. It took a minute because I eventually realized how your good could be evil spoken of. God says that you have to run with the footmen. And even though you're running with the footmen and you become weary, how can you contend with the horsemen? Amen. My footmen was my family, but I got frustrated in my position, the things that I was trying to do to help them. Amen. See, I needed to be reminded that God would not supersede the will of man. We live in a free will society where God allows us to make our own decisions and leave us to our own devices. Today, we're talking about the danger of a divided house. Don't find yourself in the place I was, doing a whole lot of good out of sync and the direction of the Father. His word says that one plant, another waters, but he gives the increase. You see, it's not about changing people, but allowing God to work through you, to be his light, through the works that you do, your attitude and your responses. Whatever you do, don't give up on your family.
But don't believe that they are being truthful.
Have you heard people say, I ride one deep. I'm a lone ranger. I don't need friends. It sounds strange and it sounds strong and it sounds confident, but personally, I don't believe that people are being truthful. As much as the world tries to tell us to be self-dependent, God created us for community. No man is an island. We need each other. We need friends. Friendship is a whole Bible theme. We were all once enemies of God, but now we, like Abraham was, are friends of God. Now that I've lived a few years, I can say without a doubt that anyone and everyone needs at least one true friend. If you have one true friend, you are blessed. If you have two true friends, you are favored by the Lord. Proverbs 17:17 says, a friend loves always. Because of this scripture, I know that everyone who comes into your circle is not a true friend. Why? Because number one, a true friend stands by your side when all others leave. A true friend will help you when the vicissitudes of life hit you down. They are empathetic to your situation and they will put themselves in your shoes. Number two, a godly friendship is not based on power, authority, or control. It's a gift that allows you to have equal respect for each other, knowing and entrusting that everything that is done is to build up, to encourage, never to tear down. A godly friend will move away from self. They seek their friend's welfare and find joy in the prosperity of each other. You can tell if you really have a true friend, because when you are blessed with what they have been praying for, they can still be happy for you. A true friend tells us what we need to hear, not what we want to hear. True friends will correct you in love, considering themselves. A true friend makes you stronger and will not participate in activities to make you weak. People you meet can be like buttons on the elevator. They can either take you up or take you down. Pray to know the difference early in your encounter. A true friend forgives. A true friendship is not one-sided. Both are willing to give the grace of forgiveness to each other. A true friend is trustworthy. You can trust a friend with some of your deepest secrets. You notice I said some, because nobody tells everybody everything about themselves. Can we just be real? You can confess your faults to a friend. They will hold your faults against you. They will not tell others about your failures. They will go in God to God in prayer with you. A true friend values the spiritual growth of friends. They will help build your faith in God and His Word. Well, you say, I wish I had a true friend. Proverbs 18:24a says, a man that has friends must show himself friendly. Check yourself. I thank God for true friends. But because we are all human, we can make mistakes in friendship. To have a godly friendship, you must be intentional. We can be hurt, misunderstood, and left alone, usually at the time we need someone the most. If you ever find yourself in this situation, don't stay stuck, but find consolation in the Word of God that says, there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. His friend will never leave you, never forsake you, will always understand you, will always help you, and will always love you. Who is this friend? You can help me, brother. Who is this friend? Who is this friend? Some calling the bread of life. Some calling the bright and morning star. Some call my deliverer. Some call in the name of God. I can go on and on and on. What's his name? What's his name? What's his name?
Thank you.
everybody. At this time, amen, we will have a liturgical dance, amen. My sister Loretta Moore and the Buck Street Praise Dancers. Come on, let's receive our young people by the words of the game.
I'm speaking.
fact, how many of us believe our miracle is already here? Hallelujah. We are so grateful, amen. We're so grateful, amen. At this time, we're getting ready to hear from one of the greatest men, as I said earlier, in Christendom. Amen. My bishop, when I'm here in the Houston, Texas area, amen, we bring you greeting from Arkansas Second. Amen. We want to put our hands together, make some noise, and let God know that we appreciate leadership in this area. None other than Bishop Prince Bryant Sr. Come on, let's show him some love. Thank you so much. Please be seated in the presence of the Lord. Give God a thunderous round of applause right now. Come on, ready to praise. Ready to praise. My. Just been feasting and fellowshipping, doing this family and friends day 2024. Long anticipated, now has arrived, and we in the midst of it now. And I'm certainly being blessed of the Lord. Oh yes, we've heard talking, we've heard singing, we've had dancing, and we're gonna have some more singing. And we're going to have some great preaching. And then we're going to take up a big offering. Put them a big offering. And it's coming from you. Say amen. Yes, man. How many got the spirit of giving? Yes. And sometimes you have that spirit, but sometimes your spirit needs help. Sometimes your spirit need help. I can't go no further looking at this program. This program is all encompassing. You got the master of ceremonies that we wanted. All the way from Arkansas. The one and only Superintendent Don Vaughn. What a preacher. He's been carrying this family friend torch for a couple of years now. He's passing the torch. Yeah. Yes. And then, yes. We got the soloist guest artist, everyone. How do you pronounce that? So that Christmas? Charismas? Yeah. Every time I miss it, that's love. So I'm going to give you some more love. We love you. One of the best. And then what can we say? I'll say more later about the preach word today. Oh my goodness, he made a bold move. Yeah. Like what the preacher talked about Friday night. He made a bold move and went for the best of the best. And that is Superintendent Nathaniel Green. Yeah. Dallas, Texas. Hard worker, and what did we put in? his hands to. God blesses it. And he works hard. He puts sweat equity in it. And then he put his money in it. His own money. And then he fed everybody today free. And how many know you eat more when you eat free? His name is nowhere on the program. Look at his humility. His name. Folk got that name stuck everywhere on the program. Okay. Here's what I want to do. And I need your help. Here's what I want to do to get this big offering today and help Brother Daniel Wright and help Buck Street Church too, by the way. If you have been invited by someone and want that to be recognized that you came on their behalf and by their invite, the best way to do that is this. Receive an envelope, write your name on there and who invited you, and put your offer in there. That will do two things. That will tell us how many persons they invited, and that will tell us how much money they brought in. So, you that desire an envelope, just raise your hand. If you desire one, to make that notification. If you want to make that notification, everybody may not want to do that. But if you want to do that, let the person know that you were here and that you supported them by your gift. Can I ask you, is that all right? What a cadre of pastors today from across the city. Pastor Craven, God bless you, sir. Superintendent Farrington, Superintendent Prince Bryant, Pastor Diamond, Pastor Caldwell, Pastor Davis, Pastor Wright, Moore, bless you today. Yes, Wright again. Did I call you Wright already? And to all of our elders. Okay, I'm going to ask let me ask you a question. I'm gonna let you do this. Do you want to march or do you want to just raise your money? I got a divided house. So, independent of the chair, everybody want to march, is that right? I'm going to ask the ushers to come down front since you want to do it this way. Let's be brief. Let's move with brevity. With your pails. And credit card machines to my right. You can give by Giblify. You can give by Cash App, Buck Street, and the Church. Everyone standing to your feet. Everyone standing.
blessings and favors increase in abundance into their lives and upon their lives. The blessing of the Lord that make it rich and added no sorrow. We decree it so, and it is so, and cannot be otherwise. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give. Let's seal that prayer with praise.
Amen. We are getting ready, amen, to hear a word from the Lord. We are so grateful to have such a wonderful artist on this evening. On this evening. Amen. I want you to know, oh, there she is. I want you to put your hands together. Give God praise. For Lady Charisma Evans. As we see her, after her, and get back in the hands of our bishop. Amen. To introduce the speaker.
Suffer it to be so. Let me augment this program that I will have to come back after the solo and make this introduction. We have a gift of God today. We have a treasure in earthen vessels.
Yes, 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 yes.
A treasure that great deposits have been made into, that we now have the coveted privilege of making withdrawals from him, from that download of deposit that God has deposited into him, both directly from the Lord and indirectly through his heritage. What a mighty heritage he possessed. What great exposure that he has been exposed to righteousness, holiness, intelligence and knowledge and wisdom, example. Now he mirrors that he has been closest to and around. It's not clear all that God is doing in his life. Sometimes you can't measure the moment by the moment. You can only measure moment after the moment when you look back on that moment, and then you know that was the moment that was a turning point, that was the moment of destiny, that was a Kairos moment in life. And sometimes you can be in that moment and not realize that that is the moment until you look back and then know. Well, let me stop waxing here. But that was from the heart. And sometimes the best thing that you can do and say is not from a screen. his passion for worship. And the Word of God has created a ministry of transformation that continues to reach around the world. He served as the senior pastor of the fastest growing church in Dallas, Texas, Grace Cathedral, that just happened to be Church of God in Christ. He also serves as the superintendent of the Grace Fellowship District of the Texas Northeastern Fellowship District of the Texas Northeastern Ecclesiastical Jurisdiction, led by Bishop Nelson J. Yadlin. Pastor Green was also elevated, yes, to the seat of the president of the International Youth Department of the greatest church in the world, the Church of God in Christ. And may I put a peg there? What an advantage and an example our youth have. And President Green. Serving under the leadership of Presiding Bishop J. Drew Sheeran. He's married to Kanisha L. Green, who served faithfully with him in life and in ministry, the proud parents of two beautiful children, Nathaniel Green Jr. Here we go. And Harris. You see, I'm from your country. And I have an accent. So I'm going to quit wilding my head. Ladies and gentlemen, my sisters and brothers, please join me in welcoming Dr. Nathaniel Green, God's servant, man of the hour, our choice for speaker on this occasion. Join me in standing when our soloist is in front of us today. Thank you.
Come on, can we clap our hands for Jesus? Our soloist, Bishop Bryant. Can we give God praise for this man to serve in the world? Bishop Bryant. And to my friend and brother, my homeboy, Dallas. Thank you, praise the Lord. Superintendent Green, Nathaniel Green. And to my other brother, Pastor Donovan. And to all of you, Buck Street. Come on, can we just give God praise in this world? He's so awesome and mighty. So look, I'm not going to delay the comment, get out of the way so I can hear my brother preach. Amen, praise the Lord. Glory to God. And so I got a little help. Can I go back a little bit? Can I just kind of do a little old school? Y'all going to sing from the audience? All right, let's see what you got.
Because the Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadow's grass, and he leads me
One day that as he was laying there, asking for change. He did not realize that God had a greater change in store for him. He reached out his beggar's cup before Peter and John, who were on their way to the temple at the hour of prayer. And he said to them, "Alms, please." Peter looked at the man and said, "Silver and gold have we none, such as we have. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." The Bible said that he didn't only rise up, but he went leaping and running into the temple. Pastor Diamond, I submit to you that this man's problem was not that he could not walk, but I submit to you his main problem was that he never had anybody to tell him that he could. Today you're holding the hand of somebody who's been dealing with some lameness in some area of their life. And all they really need to hear is the right word that will cause faith to rise enough for them to start walking again. I want you to hold that hand because you're getting ready to pray for that neighbor, but I want you to look at that neighbor and tell him, say, "Neighbor, you're getting ready to walk tonight." Tell them, "I decree and declare over your life, everything is changing after this." So I want you to take that neighbor's hand and become their chief intercessor. And for the next few moments, I want you to begin praying for them right now, that wherever they have been deficient in their faith, that God would increase their faith today. Come on, do it right now. I want you to pray for your brother. Pray for your sister. Come on, I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what your situation has been. But I am not so consumed with what's happening in my own life. I cannot call faith alive in you. And so today, Father, I ask that you would touch my brother. I ask that you would touch my sister. I ask today that you would strengthen them from the crown of their head down to the soles of their feet. We rebuke every plan and plot of the devil. Satan, the Lord rebuke you. I speak strength into my neighbor. Come on, squeeze that hand right now. Into the life of the hand I hold, I squeeze a fresh anointing. Into the life of the hand I hold, I squeeze fresh oil for the journey. Into the life of the hand I hold, I squeeze power. Squeeze that hand and holler power. Squeeze that hand and holler power. Power to walk again. Power to live again. Power to move again. Power to seize your destiny and to live your life. God, send an anointing tonight. Send an anointing that will deliver the Messiah. And an anointing that will destroy the yoke of Satan. Send an anointing that makes teaching easy. Send an anointing that will shift us forever. And Satan, we serve notice on you. Your contracts are canceled. Your powers are broken. We command you to cease and desist. Somebody holler in the name of Jesus. Let God arise and every enemy be scattered. And we will not wait until the battle is over, but we will loose those hands and clap our hands and give your name glory like it's already done. Come on, Zion, if you believe that tonight is your night for a miracle, I need you to clap your hands like thunder. Come on, clap your hands like thunder and give God the best praise. Somebody shout hallelujah. Come on, shout hallelujah. Oh. Now I beg you just to touch about two or three people and tell them tonight is your night for a breakthrough. Come on, tell them your coming was not in vain. But tell them tonight is your night for a breakthrough. Tonight is your night for answered prayer. Tonight is your night for answered prayer. Tonight is your night for deliverance. Come on, point somebody across.
across the sanctuary and say, breakthrough, breakthrough, breakthrough. If you believe it, shout glory. Some of us, we're tired of just coming to church and just having church. And I dare you to look at somebody and tell them, I'm getting everything that God has for me today. If you believe it, one more time, lean your head back and shout, breakthrough.
Just need to check the house. Is there anybody that's glad to be saved? That was all right. Let's try this. Anybody glad to be sanctified? Some of y'all still seem a little unsure. Maybe I'll get a better reply on this. Anybody glad to have the Holy Ghost? Saved, sanctified, and filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. I do speak in tongues, and I do sometimes run when nobody's chasing me. I'm just excited about my salvation. I'm glad to be saved, and we're excited about that. I am also certainly honored of the Lord to be able to stand in the presence of such great leadership. I'm certain that you don't really need me to expound much concerning how great of a leader you have. But because I think so highly of him, I must acknowledge it. Can you help me to celebrate one of the greatest leaders in all of Texas and all of the Church of God in Christ and all of our nation? Can we give God praise for the bishop, Prince Bryant? Come on, let's celebrate him tonight. He's just celebrating, praise the Lord. But we honor the Lord for Bishop Bryant. I never told him this, but I used to get nervous when I would get in his presence. Because you know, he just has such a stately demeanor. And his look stays one way. You don't know how he feel about what you're saying. But over the years, I got a chance to know him, develop my own relationship with him, and I am grateful. Amen. For the kind-hearted man that he is certainly one who is given to hospitality, lover of young men. He certainly has the heart of the church, and I'm grateful to God that our church is being led by such men as him. I want you one more time, would you clap your hands and honor one of the fathers of our church, Bishop Bryant, to celebrate you, sir. To this lovely woman of God who doesn't stand behind him, but she stands beside him. Can we give God praise for the lovely Lady Bryant on this evening? Thank God for her, always a kind word to say. I want to thank God for his family. I would call all their names, but all of his children are friends of mine. And we've all kind of come up together in this church, and I'm just so glad to see all that God is doing in their lives. And all of us are changing. I think the only one who hasn't changed much is Prince. He still got curls in his hair. And I have none. But nevertheless, I thank God for his family. They are my family. I also thank God so many familiar faces I see. I thank God my good friends are here. Pastor Jared Davis and Lady Lauren Davis. It's good to see, amen, you all tonight. Glad to have you in the room. My sister from Dallas, Charisma, it's good to see you, girl. Amen. Always tearing the church up, Pastor Diamond. It's good to see you, man. And to all of you, my father's children, one of the daughters of our church is here. Good to see you, Nadia. Didn't know you were in Houston. Amen. But to all of you, my father's children, why don't you find somebody better looking than you and tell them it's good to see you in the house of the Lord. One woman just looked puzzled like there's nobody finer than me.
And if you can't find nobody better looking, just find somebody looking and tell them it's good to see you in the house of the Lord. Now listen, my special guest is here tonight, and if you don't make radical noise for him, it's going to be very difficult to preach. But last and not least, how do we make noise for Jesus Christ? Jesus Christ. I'm going to try one more time. Jesus Christ. Somebody tell them we might as well have church now. Would you stand to your feet all over the sanctuary as we're hastening into the word of the Lord? AJ, good to see you, man. In a lovely way. 1 Samuel 30:1. Sound man, if you could just pump me up on these monitors on the stage. This is our third service. We don't have much of a voice, but there is a word from the Lord. Amen. And we want to share that with you. You can lift the house a little bit as well. And even if I get a little loud, because I am radically Pentecostal, just keep it up. Amen. 1 Samuel 30:1. If you have that, say amen. And it came to pass, when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag, and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken the women captives that were therein. They slew not any, neither great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and somebody say, behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. And then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives were taken captive, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail, the wife of Nabal the Carmelite. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all of the people was grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And he said to Abiathar the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me hither the ephod. And Abiathar brought thither the ephod to David. And David inquired at the Lord, here's the last verse, saying, shall I pursue after this troop? And shall I overtake them? And the Lord answered him, pursue. For thou shalt surely overtake them. Help me to say this last part of the verse. Everybody say, and without fail,
without fail,
recover all. I want to talk to you from this night. I want to talk to you this night from this thought. The road to recovery. The road to recovery. And I just want you to look at your neighbor, and I want you to give them that serious look that you give folk when they owe you money. Look that neighbor in the face and just tell them these words. Tell them, say, take it back. Look at somebody else and tell them, take it back. David, who is, aside from Jesus, one of my favorite Bible characters, David is in a peculiar place because he has done the unthinkable. As we examine the background to understand the context of this text, he has taken refuge amongst the Philistines. And this is very interesting, because when you note his history with the Philistines were the enemies of the Israelite nation. And David has now, as he is running from Saul for his life, he has taken refuge among the Philistines, an enemy
that once you prayed God would deliver you from, you have now taken refuge with them. And I if I can just be honest, I can almost understand how it is that David would make such a decision, because there is something, and talk to me if you can relate, there's something about being weary and tired and overwhelmed and lonely, stressed and frustrated all at the same time, that if you're not careful, you will find yourself in a vulnerable state of mind, making decisions that don't make a lot of sense. Because you're most vulnerable when you're tired. You're most vulnerable when you are fatigued. Anybody know what I'm talking about? That's why oftentimes in your warfare, it increases when you are worn out and you are fatigued, because those are the moments that the enemy finds to be the most opportune time to influence your decisions and your choices. And the question becomes, well, how do I know if I am in a vulnerable state of mind under the wrong influence? Well, number one, you know that you're in a vulnerable state of mind under the wrong influence when you become easily, somebody say, deceived. Yeah, some of us, even tonight, we have been easily deceived, and it's evident that we are easily deceived, because you will find yourself living under a false sense of security. There are some of us who have gathered here, even tonight, you've been hypnotized into a false pretense that makes you feel better about some deeper issues that you refuse to address. And David's resolve in this moment was, if I seek refuge among the very people who hate Saul, then Saul will stop hunting me to kill me. But I need you to understand, just because your warfare with Saul has ceased, that does not mean that God's will has been achieved. Because any kind of peace that you obtain outside of the will of God has no longevity. That's why you must never be deceived by peace that you had to conform to get. You ain't hearing me tonight. You must never allow yourself to become deceived by peace that you had to drop your standards to apprehend, because the God that we serve is a God who does not endorse our error, no matter how much he loves us. You know that you're in a vulnerable state of mind under the wrong influence when you become easily deceived. But here's number two. You know that you are in a vulnerable state of mind under the wrong influence when you have become easily, somebody say, displaced. This is seen when you begin giving your gifts and your abilities to the wrong purpose. And you begin giving your gifts and your abilities even to the wrong people. This is why Paul said in 2 Corinthians 2:11 that we must not be ignorant concerning the devil's devices. But some of us were falling into traps that, to be honest, matured saints just shouldn't be falling into. If we were to be honest, there are some saints here tonight, you still falling for stuff that mature saints should not be getting caught up in. Just look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, you too old for that. You too old to still be falling for the same tricks. You don't realize tricks are for kids. You still too, hear me, come on. You too old to still be lusting after the same thing, being deceived by the same thing and getting caught up. And if your neighbor ain't saying nothing, maybe it's because they're guilty. But look at the neighbor on the other side and tell them, you're too old for that. You've been in church too long to still be lying the way you lie. You're too old to still be talking about other people's business because you have none of your own. You're too old to still be chasing the skirts and you want a false leg. Come on, you're too old. You never know where you're too old. You're too old.
thing in life has caused him to suffer an identity crisis where he feels like he does not belong where he actually belongs. This is why the Bible says in 1 Samuel 27 and 5 that as he was running for his life from Saul, he comes now and approaches the Philistine king whose name was Achish and says to him, if you will allow me to take refuge among you and your people, I will become your servant and I will do whatever it is that you want me to do. But it begs one the question, how do you go from being a son of Israel to becoming a servant of a Philistine? And this is why you must be careful, because the enemy has a way of tricking us out of our place. As a matter of fact, I'll say it like this. The devil has a way of tricking you out of the place that you've been designated for. He has a way of tricking you out of the place that God actually assigned for you to be at. This is why I don't have a lot of tolerance for church hoppers who hop from place to 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 place. And they make statements like, well, the reason I left the last church I was at was because they couldn't see what was on me. They didn't see the anointing that was on my life. But I need to give you a better understanding. Maybe the problem isn't that they didn't see the anointing on you, but maybe they could also see the fool in you, and they needed to address the fool in you so that the fool wouldn't override the oil. Y'all ain't hearing what I'm saying. I want you to look at your neighbor and tell your neighbor, say, neighbor, find your place and sit down. Don't you let the devil trick you out of the place where you belong. Sit down. Don't you let the devil trick you out of the ministry where you belong. Sit down. Don't you let the devil trick you out of the career, the marriage, the assignment where you're supposed to be. Somebody holler, sit down. Because the enemy wants to trap you in a trick. I want you to look at somebody and tell them, I know where my oil belongs. That's why I don't let everybody lay claims to my oil. I don't let everybody put their handprints on my life. I don't let everybody have their way with me, because I know where my oil belongs. It is unfortunate, because we do live in a day and time where there are some who are leaving the church to go to other churches because somebody has lied to them and made them believe that the grass is greener on the other side. And it's not until they leave a sure thing to go to a questionable thing that they get over there and discover that there are patches over there, just like there are patches over here. But I've come to discover the grass ain't always greener on the other side. The grass is greener where you water it. Your neighbor, tell him, say, water your grass. David has, he's been displaced and he's been deceived, but you also know that you're in a vulnerable state of mind under the wrong influence when you have become greatly distanced from God. You find yourself wasting lengthy periods of time in a position of compromise. And this is important to note, because when you study the record of the chronicler, you'll understand that David was living with the Philistines for about 16 months. For about 16 months, he lived with the enemy in error. For 16 months, he lived in a culture that was not the culture he was called to. For 16 months, he lived amongst the wrong company, in the wrong environment, with the wrong thoughts in his head, and with the wrong spirit. And this is important, because it's a very dangerous thing for you to spend too much time in a place where you don't belong. It's dangerous, because the longer you stay out there, the more you begin changing into something that you were not called to be. I remember when my wife and I moved to Dallas several years ago. I feel good to say that now. Several years ago, when we moved to Dallas, there was a tool that I was using outside. And a few years later, I was looking for that tool and could not find it. But my wife was outside and she hollered in the house and said, Nathaniel, I found your tool. But when I looked at the tool, it looked nothing like it did when I first bought it, because it had been sitting outside in the elements. And what was once a beautiful shiny tool was now a rusty piece of junk, because too much time invested in the wrong place will bring about a spiritual erosion. You're not hearing what I'm saying today. Sometimes too much time with the wrong people, it brings about a spiritual erosion. And this is important, because for 16 months, the devil has been living with the enemy. But when you also study the chronicle of the Psalms, that God help me here today, the same period of time that David was with the Philistines, there is no record of a psalm being written. For 16 months, that means you're telling me the worshiper didn't worship. For 16 months, the prayer warrior wasn't praying. For 16 months, this son of God was not seeking the voice of God. And this is important, because the enemy wants to distance and put distance between you and God, because he wants to you away, to erode your relationship with God. And this is important, because many of you, what you don't realize is the loss of some of your stuff is really God trying to talk to you, to reveal to you you've lost something greater. Some of us, we don't pray like we used to pray. Some of us, we don't fast like we used to fast. And that's why I submit to you, that's why some of the misfortune that you've experienced, it's not always the devil operating according to his own agenda. Because the devil ain't nothing but God's pit bull on a leash. Sometimes it's the devil fulfilling God's request to get your attention, to turn you around and bring you back to where you belong. David ain't praying. He ain't singing. He's not worshiping. He's greatly distanced from the counsel of God. And some of you are probably saying right now, well, Pastor Green, that's not me, because I prayed about my decision. I've been praying about what I said I was going to do. I've been praying about what I've decided to do. But please note this. There is a difference in submitting to the counsel of God versus just waiting on God to make you feel better about a decision you've already made without God. See, some of us, that's our problem. You're praying amiss. That's what James said. Because you're praying according to your will, but your ears aren't to the mouth of God enough to know what is God's will for my life. But I want to know, is there anybody in here that can testify, I still want God's will for my life? I still want to know, what is God saying about my future? What is God saying about my destiny? What is God saying about my next choice? Somebody lift up your hands and holler, I need to hear from God. The plot begins to thicken. Because David not only positions himself to live with the Philistines. Here is what blows my mind. Here is really what I believe is the tension in the text. He begins positioning himself to fight with the Philistine. This is interesting to me, because now, David, you've gone too far. Because now you're willing to fight to defend the very ones who you used to fight against. And that's when you know you've gone too far. When you fight to justify error, that's when you know that you've gone too far. When you fight to defend what is the direct antithesis of what your God stands for. Look at your neighbor and tell them, don't you get too far. Some of us, it's evident that we've gotten too far, because we're allowing things in our homes that at one time we did not allow. You know you've gonna raise like that. So why are you letting your child do that? Look at somebody, tell them, don't go too far. We demonize how it is that we were raised when you turned out all right. And we make statements like, well, I ain't gonna do that to my child. I ain't gonna restrict my child. But that's what helped to keep you safe. That's what helped. I can't find no help here. That's what helped to keep you in alignment. But we're justifying error. The God that we serve is the kind of God that says, when you get too far, I've got to redirect you. God, help me here today. And we find David on a road of destruction on his way to the road of recovery. Oh, God has beauty to me. Yeah, he finds himself on the road of destruction on his way to the road of recovery. Because God said, David, I need to get you out of this error and out of this compromise, because I cannot endorse you the way that I want to endorse you, living the way that you're living. And David finds himself on the road to recovery. And I've come to prophesy tonight at the historic Buck Street Church of God in Christ to let somebody know God wants to put you on the road to recovery. Come on, would you look at your neighbor and tell him, say, neighbor, God wants to put you on the road to recovery. Well, what does it look like for God to put me on the road to recovery? Well, let me help you. Number one, when you're on the road to recovery, you can expect to be somebody holler attacked. Because the Bible says that the Amalekites had invaded Ziklag while David was lining his men up with the Philistines. They burned Ziklag with fire, took their women and their children. And while they were getting ready to fight an enemy that they could see, they were attacked by an enemy that they could not see. And I want to know, is there anybody that's ever felt like this? I didn't see this coming. Have you ever gone through a season of your life where you were hit by something that you did not see coming? Because there were some attacks that God could have stopped, but God said, this attack is necessary to get you back in my wheel. Yeah, God allowed, God, the Amalekites to hit them in a vulnerable place. It hit them so hard that the men began crying until they had no more tears to cry with. Life had literally squeezed them like a sponge dry. And the Bible said they cried and they cried. It was as if this attack had knocked the wind out of them. Is there anybody in here that's ever had the wind knocked out of you? I mean, have you ever gotten hit so hard that you thought recovery was not possible? And these men had the wind knocked out of them. They took their wives and their children, which was prophetic of the devil's desire to rob you of your ability to produce and your ability to have a legacy and a future for your bloodline. They robbed them of their future. But I want to tell somebody, God sent me all the way from Dallas to notify you, all can be taken, but that does not mean that all is lost. Yes, God, help me. Look at somebody and tell them, all may be taken, but all is not lost. I've come to tell somebody today, the devil may have tried his best to put his hands on your stuff and take it away, but God said, don't worry, I'm not going to let him destroy it all. I'm just using him to get your attention. When you're on the road to recovery, you can expect to be attacked. But number two, when you're on the road to recovery, talk back to me if you can relate to this, you can expect to be abandoned. Have you ever been abandoned? Yeah, the Bible said that David was greatly distressed because the men were so upset with their eyes filled with tears. game of stoning David because their souls were heavy with grief. Now, Prince, it's one thing for me to be attacked by an enemy, but there's nothing more hurtful than you've been attacked by your own. Is there anybody that knows anything about attacks that come from people who you thought had your back? Yeah, they had my back all right, and they had about four knives in my back. And then there's nothing more hurtful, to have to suffer attack from the people that you loved. David even said later in life, in Psalm 55 and 12, I could have handled being assaulted by my enemy, but I never expected this from my family, not from my friend. We took sweet counsel together. We walked into worship together. And someone might ask, why was David so distressed? Because David is saying, how many more times would I have to live my life on repeat? For I've been abandoned by my father. He doesn't want to claim me. I've been abandoned by my brothers. They're jealous of me. I've been abandoned by my mother. And her abandonment was so bad that nobody ever writes of her. I've been abandoned by my father-in-law. He wants to kill me. And now the 600 men who found me in 1 Samuel, the 22nd chapter, in the cave of Adullam, now they want to kill me. Here's what makes it worse. In 1 Samuel 22, it said there were 600 men who had joined themselves to David while they were distressed and discontented and disheartened. But by the 30th chapter of 1 Samuel, the Bible is telling us that they have wives and children that have been taken. And this is what offends me the most. When you came to me, you had nothing. But now you've grown under me and you want to kill me. I can't find no help in this church. Look at your neighbor, ask your neighbor, have you ever been abandoned? Have you ever been mishandled by people that you've done so much for? Have you ever been abandoned by people that you've given your life to? Have you ever been abandoned? Abandoned by people who you thought were on your side. And one of the worst feelings in the world is the feeling of betrayal when you discover that they never loved you the way that you loved them. Oh, but here's the turn in the text, because I heard David at another time in life when he said, when my father and my mother forsake me, the hope is the Lord. The Lord will take me up. And I've come to tell somebody tonight, that's why sometimes God will allow the people that you love to abandon you and to drop you, all so that he can be the one to catch you. Why don't you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, y'all ain't talking right. I need you to get some wind in your belly and get some vocality in your throat and say, neighbor, y'all still ain't talking right. I need you to look them eyeball to eyeball and say, neighbor. Tell them I got good news for you. Tell them the good news is they may have abandoned you, but you are not alone. For the Bible declares that while David felt like he was by himself, a light cut on in his mind, and he remembered what he used to do that he had not been doing for 16 months. He remembered getting on his knees and getting in the face of God, which brings me to my third point. You know you're on the road to recovery when you find yourself in a position to acknowledge God. For the Bible says in the B clause of the sixth verse that David encouraged himself God. And he said to Abiathar, the priest, Ahimelech's son, I pray thee, bring me the ephod. This is a big deal, because the ephod is used for worship in the temple. But David said, I'm too far from the temple, and I'm in dire straits, and I've got to find a way to get the temple to me. Y'all ain't hearing me here. And that's why sometimes you better learn how to call on God, even when you're by yourself. Because sometimes when you're going through and you can't get to the church, you better learn how to have church all by yourself. Is there anybody in here that knows what I'm talking about? Where you were dealing with trouble on every side, and you called the preacher, but you could not get him. And you called the missionary, but you could not get him. And you called the pastor, and you could not get him. But why don't you look at your neighbor and tell him, say, neighbor, learn how to call Jesus, because he'll answer prayer. David got on his knees and said, Father, I stretch my hand unto thee. Now, help I know if thou withdraw thyself from me, where shall I go? Tell your neighbor, call on the Lord, because he still answers prayer. Call on the Lord, because he still hears you. Call on the Lord, because he's still able. As a matter of fact, if I've got somebody that believes it, I tell you to leap on your feet, open up your mouth, and for about 30 seconds, lift up your voice, and ask the Lord to help you. Do it right now. Come on, somebody, open up that mouth, because you need God to show up. That's why the songwriter said, I need thee every hour. I need thee. Oh, bless me now, you, my Savior. I come to you. That's what the songwriter said. Unto the hills from which comes my help. Tell your neighbor, all of my help comes from the Lord. That's what the songwriter said. With my hands lifted up and my heart filled with praise, with the heart of thanksgiving, I will bless thee, O Lord. That's what the songwriter said. I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall knees when you got on the altar and you said, Father, I need your help. Now you're in your 30s. Now you're in your 40s. Now you're in your 50s. Now you're in your 60s. And you act like you can't cry out to God. But somebody throw up your hands. Somebody else, let's step into it. And look at that neighbor. See, most people, they only focus on recovering the material, and you will. But I heard him in Matthew when he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And what? It will be added unto you. We're shouting to get stuff, but you ought to shout to get God. And he says, I've got God. The stuff will come looking for me. Doors of opportunity will come looking for me. I'll never forget, everybody standing. I'm done, I promise. And so I'll never forget. There was a period of my life where I had become so consumed with my possessions that I had lost sight on my relationship with God. And when the possessions began to leave me, I didn't realize it was God trying to get my attention. You've fallen in love with the creation, but you've forgotten about the Creator. But if you could just hold on tight to me, I'll secure the quality of life that you prefer. It's about making God priority. And I need you to hear me loud and clear. Because in a moment, I'm going to open this altar. Is that right? I'm going to open this altar. But I don't want you to do that thing we do in church where we put on masks to impress people who ain't thinking about us. And we act like we have no challenges, no issues. I started a noonday prayer at my church on Wednesdays. And the Lord spoke to me and said, son, I want you to keep my people on the altar. But as often as you put them on the altar, you get down there with them. I don't want you to forget what got you where you are. It's your relationship with God that shifts the game for you. And tonight there may be somebody that's saying, you know what, I really need another dose. I need you to take off your elder's license. Take off your missionary's license. Take off who you feel you have to be in front of people. Stop perfecting the image of a God that you no longer know. And I want you to run down to this altar if you're saying, I need a refill. I need another dose. I need God to touch my heart all over again. If that's you tonight, I dare you to run to this altar right now. If you say, I just need a little bit more of God. I need a little bit more of his spirit. I need a little bit more of his anointing. If that's you, I want you to come right now. You might be a pastor. You might be a deacon. Come on, I wish we wouldn't do the fake thing. Come on, God has something for you. But God said, I cannot address what you continue to hide. I need you to be honest about where you are deficient. Come right now. There are a few more of you that said, I need God to revamp some things in my spirit. Somebody right now, you're running on empty. You're just a little burnt out. And you said, God, I know you called me, but I'm tired. I'm weary. I'm spent. And I need another dose. Come on to this altar. Come. Come on, come. From wherever you are, come. Hallelujah. And I want you to lift, squeeze in at this altar. I want you to lift your hands as high as you can. Glory to the name of the Lord. Lift your hands as high as you can. And when I count to three, I want you to open up your mouths. And I want you to do one simple thing. I want you to cry out for two things. I want you to ask the Lord to help you and to fill you. Come on, somebody say, help and fill me. Those of you who are in the pew, I'm assuming you have all of God that you need. So I want you to intercede for those who are on this altar. For those of you on the altar, lift up those hands when I count to three. I want you to cry out for help and that he would fill you. Can I get some oil? Glory to God. One. Come on. Two. Come on. Three. Come on. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. Lift up your voice. I need him to help me. And I need him to fill me. Come on, help me. Fill me. Help me. Fill me. Hey. Help me. Fill me. Help me. Fill me. Jesus, help me. I'm dealing with some stuff that I can't talk about, but help me. I'm dealing with frustration that I cannot talk about, but Lord, I need your help tonight. Help me, help me. Feel me from the crown of my head down to the soles of my feet. Jesus, send your spirit. Send your anointing. Spirit of the living God, help me. Fall fresh. Reignite my fire. Fall fresh. Set me ablaze. Fall fresh. Restore my passion. Fall fresh. Restore my zeal. Jesus, help me. Somebody tell them, help me. Feel me. I need the oil. I need me. Woo! Every eye. Bless me now, my Savior. Oh, yeah. Bless me now. To you. I'm weary. I'm tired. I'm wounded. But I come to you. I'm lost. But I come to you. I bring you my pain. I bring you hope. Set you on fire again. There's somebody who said, lift up your hands and say, yes, Lord. If you're ready for him to fill you again, say, yes, Lord. My heart says yes. My mind says yes. My will, your circle is changing. My will says yes. Yeah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I surrender. Yes, Lord. I give up all. Yes, Lord. Help me out. Yes, Lord. 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 Come on. Somebody holler, yes, Lord. Somebody holler, yes, Lord. Heal my body. Yeah, you know that I'm so healed. You tell me that I say, yes. Yes, Lord. Come on, somebody say yes, Lord. Somebody say yes, Lord. My soul says yes. My heart says yes. My mind says yes. My will says yes. Everybody give those hands up. Lean your head back and say yes, 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 yes. My answer will be yes. My answer will be yes. Recover all. Come on, throw your arms around somebody. Tell them you will recover all. I've come to tell you your eyes have not seen. Your ear has not heard. It hasn't entered into your heart. God has it all. I don't care what you lost. When you get God on your side, you got all you need to recover. Come on, hug somebody else and tell them you will recover. Oh, yeah. Oh, my God, my God, my God, my God, my God. Yeah. in this third month of the year, you're getting ready to see evidence of recovery. I want you to lift up your voice one more time and just give God a shout out of your belly. And after you finish shouting out your belly, take it out your mouth and put it in your feet. Come on, 1, 2, 3, open your mouth. Shout. Everybody lift your hands and say this with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I believe you are the Son of God. You died for my sins. You were buried in the grave. But 3 days later, you rose with all power in your hand. Tell them, and because of your blood and your sacrifice, somebody holler, I'm saved. If you're glad about it, clap those hands and give praise. Life now is sweet, and my joy is complete, for I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved. I found who is all to me. Come on, help me say that. His love is ever true. Come on. I love to tell how he lifted me and what his grace can do. For you, thank God, by his power divine, saved to new life, some life. Life now is sweet, and my joy is complete, for I'm saved, saved, saved.
y'all say amen? For the message. For the message. And for the messenger on today. Just repeat after me. I have received
all I need
to recover all.
To recover all.
Don't give God a hand clap. Don't clap a praise. Don't clap a praise. What a powerful, and pungent, relevant, challenging, impactful word today. God has spoken to us in a definite way. Thank you, Superintendent Green, for allowing the Lord to use you and to release some of those deposits that he had deposited into your life for the betterment of the Lord's people. And because of it, we are better.
Yes, yes, yes.
And we will be better. Well, time is sad to come to a conclusion of a great event. Where's Deacon Wright? Come to the mic. Come on to the mic. Come on up to the big mic, boy. Give him a thunderous round of applause.
Amen. Thank you, Bishop. Amen.
I'm just a worker, but I really want to appreciate everyone that came out on today. I just, especially, I know we've been around the problem, but I want to appreciate my bishop once again. And appreciate my first lady for love and support and entrusting me with the Buckshew Memorial Church of God in Christ Family and Friends Day event. I know this always been a baby of Buckshew, and I pray that I have served you well on today. Amen. I want to give a special thanks to Superintendent Green.
Amen.
I've never met him, but I watched him online, and somebody said, how in the world did you book Superintendent Green? All I can tell him is favor is not fair. Amen. Amen. I want to thank Sister Latrina, Oliver. She had to leave for praise and worship. Thank you, Charisma. She always blesses us. This host of musicians, thank you all. Amen. And this choir. Brother Wesley Gray. Amen. If you feel like you can't carry a tune in a bucket, you just come to him and bring your bucket. He can put the tune in there. Amen. Thank you for the praise dancer, Sister Loretta. Thank you, everybody. But I have to give a special thanks. I have to do this. Buckshew has supported the fundraising for this event. You supported. But there are some people who's not even a member of Buckstreet who has walked in here, rolled up their sleeve, and worked and sweated and worked. People thought they were members here. But I want to give a special thanks to my co-workers back there, Sister Latasha Green, Lawrence Green, Sister Deidre White, Brother Eric White. Amen. And I just want to, we have another one here. There's two more to help did the fish fry, but I can't pronounce their name, but I think I'm like Bishop. But if you have some of that fried fish on there, Sunday, you know what I'm talking about. But I know we had a couple of concerns of people who saying, the tradition is started at 3 o'clock. But this year we started at 4, a little bit later. But today you can see good things come to those who wait. Good thing, you can't keep doing the same thing over and over and expect change. I thank God for you, Superintendent Green. You have blessed me on today. And I just feel that my spirit is like a part two to this family and friends. I can just see Superintendent Green for 2024, the family and friends. So I want to, this is a booking right now for 2025. Amen. But last but I just thank you for everybody who came supporting. Thank you, Pastor Diamond. That's where I got my start at. I appreciate you supporting. Thank you to the ARB family. Thank you to everybody, and that's all I have to say.
Say amen.
Amen.
Go back with the deacons. Say amen. Let's give them another hand. All of you can hear in this church. We love you so much. And not only do we love you, we respect you so highly. All right. Come back, Superintendent Green, and give us a part in the statement, then give us the benediction.
Shall we stand to our feet? It was certainly good for us to be together all this evening. If my prayers and the word of the Lord would not just be something that you reflect on as you're pulling off from the parking lot, but let it stay with you all week. Look at somebody and tell them, I'm coming into recovery. Hallelujah. It's a progressive recovery, a perpetual, continual recovery. Tell somebody else, I'm coming into recovery. So, Father, we thank you for all that our eyes have seen and our ears have heard. We thank you for the move of the Spirit that we've encountered tonight. We thank you for our pastor, our bishop, Bishop Bryant. We thank you, Father, for his leadership. We thank you for the Buck Street Church of God in Christ. We thank you for our dear brother who worked so hard to coordinate this event and all of the saints who put their hand to the plow to cause us to have this momentous experience. Now, as we leave this place, but never your presence, we ask that you would watch over us, guide us in that mode of transportation. Stay back the hand of the mugger, raper, and robber, and all that would offend. Until we meet again, grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father. In the holy and matchless name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And all the people of the Lord said, amen.
Amen,
amen and amen. You are dismissed.